All right. Hello. My name is Spencer Crum. I work for IBM. Can this come up? I'm a little taller. I work for IBM, and in case there was no obvious indicators. And this talk is called Code Review for Operations. Let's tip it maybe this way. What's a sound check for? Anyway, this is me. So no one can read that. Blue on black, but I did tweet out like pretty recently the links to this slide on the web, so anyone who can't see this can just follow along, and maybe the conference can retweet me or whatever, and then like you should be able to follow along from your iPad if you don't want to, if you can't see the slides very well. I'm an American. I'm from Portland, Oregon. I'm thrilled to be in South Africa, my first time. You have a wonderful country. One of the things I like to ask is like, who traveled today? Who traveled to be here today? Okay. Who traveled the furthest? You? How far did you travel? All right, I traveled from America. Can anybody beat that? Yes. No. Oh, we have a winner. What? I did not understand that joke. Anyways, I live in Portland, Oregon. It's a beautiful city. Whenever I go places, I like to tell people that it's wonderful. However, I did that too many times and too many Californians showed up. So now I'd like to report that Portland is terrible. It is full of people. It's full. You cannot buy a house there. It's on a tectonic plate that is about to explode. Don't go. I want to give a special shout out to Dougal Matthews over at Red Hat because it turns out we wrote very similar talks. And his talk looks at code review from a perspective of like, as you're an OpenStack developer and you want to do effective code review, or you're any kind of developer and you just want to have more code review in your environment, like what are the techniques and skills and stuff that you want to do in order to do that? And my talk kind of comes at it from the same angle, but with an operations bent to it. And we sat down and we kind of compared notes, and I took a lot out of his talk. So I really want to give a shout out to him. It's called Effective Code Review. You should if you like this talk, you should watch it. In fact, even if you don't like this talk, you should watch it because I think he does a better job. So who am I? My name is Spencer Crum. I work on a bunch of stuff. So primarily, I think my number one job is to work on the OpenStack project. So how many people have heard of OpenStack? I'm sorry. No, I kid. We just made a Pike release, a Newton release? We made a release of something. So I work on the infrastructure team for OpenStack. So what that means is that OpenStack is an open source project, just like Debian or something. And rather than use GitHub and Travis CI, we actually have our own code hosting, we have our own testing, we have our own release pipeline. Like everything is done as an open source project by the community. So my coworkers all work at different OpenStack companies, and we collaborate together to build this infrastructure. And the way we collaborate is using kind of a lot of the DevOps tools. I'm sorry, their DevOps tools don't exist, but they do, I guess. And so we have, you know, Puppet Code and Ansible Code and OpenStack servers, and we collaborate on a code base, and that code base turns into an infrastructure that runs and is used by hundreds of people every day. I'm also one of the organizers for the Portland version of this event in DevOps Days, so if you want to come check out that city that's about to explode, you know, hit up our CFP. Siegel is another conference in Seattle, and then there's an Open Infrastructure Day at Scale. Scale is the Southern California Linux Expo in Los Angeles, probably the oldest form of Linux Fest available. And we got a room there to talk about how you do infrastructure in the open, and infrastructure that supports open source projects and stuff like that. So if you're interested in that, any of that stuff, hit me up. If you're a Puppet person, I work with a project called Vox Populi, which is kind of a many-to-many relationship between Puppet modules and Puppet module maintainers, because that way modules don't become unmaintained and module authors don't feel overwhelmed with pull requests and angry contributors. So that's a whole bunch of stuff. But what I'm really going to talk about today is this kind of idea of how you do code review as an operations engineer. You know, what kind of code an operations person is going to review, what behaviors kind of come out of your operations team doing code review. And a lot of that comes out of my experience working in the OpenStack infrastructure team and then other companies that I was at before that. There was this larger company that used to make printers and then split into two companies, but I'm not going to say the name. So infrastructure is code. is a term that I need to define in order to go forward. I'm sure a lot of people in this room sort of know, have their own definition, but I'll give you my little flavor of it. Basically, I think it's some kind of infrastructure changes that are done by a central machine. So we stop personally touching the servers, and we touch the machine, and the machine touches the servers. And then it's deterministic from code, so we don't even actually touch the machine. We scratch files on the machine, and then run ./do it, and then the machine configures the servers or whatever. And then we put it on a regular cadence, so we don't even actually run ./do it. We just scratch the files on the machine, and then eventually the server will run the code and ./do it and configure the servers. And then we track the code in version control. So now we don't actually have to go to the machine and scratch files anymore. We just check them into Git. I have my laptop. I push to master on some cadence. The machine pulls from master, checks out some infrastructure as code, runs ./do it. And the next thing you know, the servers have been configured. And then the final layer for me, which is really what I want to talk about today, is that we review, our peers review that code. So instead of, like, the big difference I'm talking about is everything is the same, except instead of git push origin master on your laptop, when you want to make a change, you submit that up to some GitHub or Garrett or whatever it is, and you say, hey, coworkers or collaborators, I would like to make these changes to the server. I've written this code. Please review it. And they provide feedback like, hey, your code really sucks, man. You should write better code. Or they say something like, this looks great, and they rubber stamp it, and it goes in. And we're going to talk about, like, both sides of that and what it is. It definitely says changes performed, and maybe that might, you know, for the more puppety people, that might be state asserted. But really what I'm getting at here is the reviewed by peers part. That's what the talk is about, or supposed to be. It's also some jokes, but that's, I can't help that. So code review. So what do I mean by code review? So when you do, like, when you're going to give a talk on code review and you start doing research into code review, there's all these people that do code review in this really weird way where they just lock all the developers in a room and make them read all the code that they'd written for about 4 days until they all quit. That sounds terrible. There's like Eclipse plugins to make that kind of code review easier. So what I'm talking about with code review, I'm talking about pre-merge code review, where basically you close the master branch to pushes or trunk or whatever you're using, and you say that the only way to get code into mainline is through having it reviewed by somebody else who's kind of a stakeholder, some kind of developer. And so this means that basically no code goes in without one person writing it and one person reading it. In OpenStack, which is kind of where a lot of my experience derives from, we have a two approver rule. So basically one person writes it, a second person reviews it and gives the +2 vote, it's called. And then the second person comes along and gives a +2 vote. And when that second +2 comes, that person is expected to land the code as well. There's a second vote you give in order to cause the robots come along and merge the code. They land the code. So one of the interesting things about this idea is like how it relates to like pairing. So I don't actually do a lot of pair programming. I work remotely in Portland, Oregon. Like my nearest coworker is miles and miles away. We very rarely sit down. I also consider myself much more of a system administrator, really, than a developer. So I don't have a lot of experience pairing. But one of the interesting things you see when people do sit down to pair on this is that they will kind of share the same headspace and then write the code together and then submit the code and the other person kind of approves it and then it lands. And that isn't bad because we did get two people to look at it. But part of the point of doing this code review where you have someone else analyzing it after you write it is to get out of that headspace and have someone else page it in fresh. They didn't go through 5 iterations of that code. They don't have the same assumptions you are, and maybe they don't make the same mistakes you do. So there's good parts and bad parts of how this relates to pairing, generally around getting too close to it. So just to establish sort of what I mean when I say the OpenStack infrastructure project, I should maybe classify like a little bit. We run this developer infrastructure, which doesn't sound that hard. I think a lot of you probably support some developers. I support a lot of developers. So we have like 600 Git repos, and it increases basically every day. In 1 6-month cycle between January and July of this year, we made 20,000 commits to those 600 Git repos. And to those 20,000 commits, we as a project lodged over 100,000 reviews. 100,000 different votes and comments and stuff on those 20,000 patches, which doesn't even touch how many lines of code that is and stuff like that. It's an enormous project with huge velocity and support from every big company you've ever heard of. It's very exciting, and it requires quite a bit of infrastructure to run. So I actually am kind of in a privileged place because we have both traditional long-running services that you kind of manage traditionally and an elastic kind of cloud thing that boots virtual machines and kills virtual machines as it load dependent. So I get to kind of have feet in both kinds of infrastructure, which is pretty nice. So I wanted to use some vocab in front of everybody just because I'm going to use these words a lot. I've already started using them and probably lost some people. But basically, when I say a review, I'm talking about, you know, somebody has written a patch that they would like to land on master, and then they submit that, and then it's like a GitHub pull request is a review. The change is actually the same thing, but we call them reviews and changes generally in OpenStack. And these are terms largely growing out of Garrett, which is the code review system we use in OpenStack, which was written by Google. It's also used by the Chromium project and the Android project and the Typo3 project. A robot for me is just kind of any automated process. So you'll hear me say like, a robot does blank, a robot merges it, or a robot runs the code, or a robot runs the tests, and then the robot might come back and do something else. But anytime something has just been automated where it gets, waits for events, receives events, does tasks, and does something else, to me that's a robot. Confusingly, review is also a verb. So when I review code, I'm talking about, or I'm leaving a review, that's me applying, feedback onto that proposed change. And that might be good, it might be negative, it might be this should land now. In OpenStack, we actually break it down a little bit, but we don't have time to get into that. Landing is the act of actually whatever the final step is. It's like in GitHub, it's merge pull request button. In ours, it's plus A. And then at that moment, like it's kind of hands off. It's like the timer stops. And now the machines will make sure that code is in master and whatever happens is going to happen. Core is specific to open source, which may or may not be relevant to you, but basically, whenever we're in an open source project, there's usually two groups of developers. There's the core and the not core. And the core, there's the people with the commit bit. The core are the people that have the ability to land changes, and the non-cores have the ability to review, they have the ability to propose, but they don't have the ability to land. And now, usually, most people who are not core and actively involved are going to get core, and if your open source project doesn't have a process for taking contributors and turning them into commit bit contributors, you have a broken project and you should fix that. Finally, there's this idea of the patch set, which really gets into the repetition and communication part of code review, and is lost a little bit for those of you that are more experienced with GitHub. So Garrett, for instance, is what we use. So I propose a patch, and then I get some minus feedback, like, hey, you should probably capitalize these variable names or something. I'm like, okay. So I go back to that Git branch, and I change it, and I get commit dash dash amend, and I resubmit it. And then what that does in Garrett's side is it actually creates patch set 2. And I get some more feedback, and I have to change it again, and I submit it again, and it creates patch set 3. And these are different versions of the proposed change over time. Right now, GitHub has the ability for you to update a pull request, but it's very hard to go back and see what this pull request diff looked like, a week ago when people provided comments and feedback. And it's really pointless, in my opinion, to do a whole lot of pull requests and code review if you're not actually going to do changes. If people are just rubber stamping and saying, yeah, this looks like code, approved, you're not actually getting anything out of it. So you need to actually, one of the metrics you should be looking at here while you're looking at code review is how many times are we actually asking people to kind of do rework? When are we asking them to fix it up? When are we actually asking for improvements? Just kind of going through the motions. All right, so in OpenStack, we do a lot of stuff with Git, and we do a lot of stuff with code review. So basically anything we can, we put into Git, and we have robots manage. And then anything that we can put into Git, we go through code review. So if you want to do some things, you have to propose a patch or a pull request. We call it a patch, but So we run all these software daemons. If you want to change the software in the software daemon, pretty straightforward. You just write some Python, submit a patch, somebody approves it, the robots will eventually continuously deploy that. If you'd like to change the configuration of the daemons, you go to the right Puppet repo or the right Ansible repo, you modify something, you submit it, people approve it, eventually more robots will eventually reload daemons to pick up new configuration changes. If we want to put new servers or users out on the servers or packages or files, that's all done through the same Ansible Puppet technologies that you know. We also have this kind of ephemeral, like elastic cloud, and that elastic cloud boots images that we generate daily. And so our image generation is also managed through, you know, kind of shell scripts and Git. And if you want to modify what's in the, you know, we want to put Emacs in the developer image that's going to boot 500 times a day, you can do that. And you go through Git to do it, and you go through code review. If you want to modify our docs, you go through code review. If you want to modify what tests your OpenStack project is going to run, you go through code review. There's this giant 7,000 line YAML file that it takes a village to maintain. And one very smart German. We have 600 Git repositories, and if you'd like a new one, you go to a very specific YAML file and you add your new lines to it and you submit that to the code review system, and when people approve it, the robots make you a new Git repo. And if you'd like ACLs for that Git repo, you modify a different YAML file that goes and get, you know, creates groups or something for you when it lands. And if you want an IRC channel for your new project, for your new repo, you go to a different YAML file. And when you propose and people approve it and then it lands and the robots and then it goes and it talks to ChanServe and it gets it all registered on Freenode and stuff. And yeah, so like basically anything you could possibly think of, we go through code review. If you want to build a specification for future work, that goes through code review. If you would like to run for an OpenStack elected position, you have to make a position statement and add it to a Git repo and go through code review. If you'd like to run some jobs from one project and some jobs from another, you have to go back to that 7,000 line YAML file. If you'd like to release a piece of software in OpenStack, you modify a YAML file. If you'd like to add a new dependency globally to OpenStack, you modify a requirements.txt file, but it still goes through code review. If you want a Grafana dashboard on our Grafana, you have to go modify some YAML in a specific repository, propose it for review, get -1 to bunch, and then do it again, and then eventually you'll get your dashboard. If you want a meeting in our IRC meeting room, you have to check it out using a YAML file. Like, as you see the pattern here, infrastructure is code, yeah. Anyways, so point is, we take it maybe a little bit further than you need to, but infrastructure as code is totally viable, and it's almost like project management, organization, community management as code is becoming more real for us. And having done this at multiple companies, and then in this way too complicated open source project, I have some thoughts on what it ends up looking like when you have infrastructure as code and you're doing a lot of code review. And really what I'm talking about here is like the organizational and human elements to this. So why do people do it? Well, the first reason they do it is because they want less defects, right? Anytime someone else looks at something I've done and they're like, hey man, that's just never gonna work. You misspelled that. Wrong. Somebody else already did this work. Anytime somebody else has given you just the once over, you're gonna make sure that you produce more quality and less defects. And that is way easier to catch before that stuff lands than it is to clean up after. The second thing is that, you know, the big three. The second for me is that it creates a wide spread of information. So instead of me working in my little silo and somebody else working in their little silo, and then we both just push to master and then go home for the day, we're now in a place where me and this other person are constantly checking each other's work. And so whether I'm super engaged with their project or not, I absolutely know what the code is looking like. I'm aware of the code evolving. I'm seeing it change. And everyone else in the organization is as well. You're reviewing code almost as much, if not twice as much more, than you're writing it. So you have a great understanding of the churn in the code base, which means you have a greater understanding of the infrastructure that you're responsible for maintaining. And that is huge. The third thing for me, going back to the Phoenix project, is it slows down your Brents. So how many people actually read the Phoenix project? Okay, so there's this guy in the Phoenix project called Brent. Well, we've all worked with Brent, and Brent basically is that super ninja that nothing can go forward without Brent's help. Like, he knows the database, and he knows the file server, and he knows the weird application, and he's the only person that can write JavaScript. And so every time this poor IT organization wants to get anything done or repair any issue, they can't do it until they get Brent, and Brent becomes this limiting reagent in the entire organization. And no one can get what's in his head out of his head. No one can write down all the hacks he's done to keep it running. We've all worked with this person. Some of us have been this person. Not me, though. And so if you tell this Brent person that, if you tell the organization that we're not going to just let anybody kind of cowboy, we're going to have to say, like, if you want to do something to the servers, you have to go through this code review process. And somebody else has to page in your entire change and then approve it. That slows down Brent. Now, maybe that slows down the entire organization, but it means that other people have a handle of what's going on in the system, what the repair is, why the issue is there. And hopefully your less skilled engineers are comfortable giving Brent a minus one, like, hey, I have no idea what these Java JVM args that you've set are. Can you explain it to me? And then he gets a link to some Oracle documentation that is behind a paywall, and then they approve it anyway. Because, you know, Oracle. All right, so organizational changes that come if you start doing this, like if you actually say we're not going to push to master anymore on our Puppet repo, which is really the core of what I'm talking about here, there's some things that show up immediately, and the number one is merge speed, right? You're used to writing code and then pushing the code, and then you're on to the next task. And what happens is you write the code and you submit the code, and then you're on to the next task, actually, because there's nothing for you to do. You actually have to wait for other people's feedback. And then they give you this feedback, and it's negative. And you have to do the work again, and you're not getting, your manager's like, why haven't you done this simple task? And you're like, putting Emacs on the servers is harder than I thought it would be. There's a lot of feedback. And so you have to do a bunch of revisions and other people, and you have to wait for reviews, that kind of stuff. So you're just going to have to go a lot slower. But the idea is that it's going to be worth it for you to do that. One of the amazing things, though, is your audibility, right? Whenever you're dealing with an environment, especially some kind of like an, we're sysops. How many times, I don't know how many times I've gone through like the Puppet repo or something from before code review, and there's like, I'm looking at why is this package installed or something, and I'd run git blame, and the commit message is do the needful. And I'm like, sweet, that's super descriptive. no ticket number, just gotta do it. Do the stuff. And so if instead when you write a patch that says, you know, add Emacs to the servers, which is gonna be my example throughout, if you are writing that commit message for a coworker that doesn't know what's going on, they are not sitting right next to you, they are not you, you have to write explicitly why you think this package needs to be on there. You submit it for review, and then you and your coworkers or co-collaborators or co-conspirators will have a conversation about why you need that package and blah, blah, blah. And so someone going through trying to use the advantage of having our infrastructure as code in Git, which is exploring the history, figuring out when things changed and why, you have all this ability to see why things happened the way they did, who approved it, what was the reasoning there. You can go talk to these people. You can see why your infrastructure changed, not just how it changed. Interestingly enough, when you do this, though, like what you've done when you made that change from just the server configure, the machine configures the servers, to the Git server pokes the machine to pokes the servers, you've moved access control out of whatever weird pseudo group permissions LDAP thing you had into your version control system. So your GitLab thing or whatever you set up now is like the keys to the kingdom. And that can be terrifying because probably it was written in Rails or something, and or you don't even run it and you just pay GitHub to run it and you hope they never get hacked, right? So that's terrifying, but those systems, you know, written as like modern web applications, have a much better understanding of groups and roles and general RBAC than anything that Unix has really provided to us outside of some really crazy stuff that no one does anyway, right? So you can actually have a group of developers that are allowed to like approve Puppet changes to some of the servers and stuff like that. It really gives you the ability to empower people more than you might be thinking sitting in these chairs right now, and you should explore that while being very afraid and cautious. Anybody who says they have perfect test coverage for their infrastructure code is lying. Sorry. Small changes can have a huge impact. So sometimes it's not a 500-line patch. It's one number in a YAML file that is like our gain on our control system for booting virtual machines. And if we screw that up, we might cost $500,000 in a month or something crazy like that. So you can look at very small changes because it's operational and they might be scary. And one of the ways that you can manage that risk of like this is small and could get out of hand quickly is you don't just use one reviewer or two reviewers. You actually you wait for the entire team to weigh in, and it's like one of those, we will together summon Captain Planet or this change to increase our quota or whatever, you know. And this allows the entire ops team, everybody can weigh in and everybody knows what's about to happen and they see this crazy change coming down the pipe and so on and so forth. All right, so those are some instances. What are the the human behaviors, like how do people actually interact with the code review system? How do they change a little bit? And what I mean kind of is gaming it. And so the first one, so remember OpenStack and even the companies I've worked at has this two reviewer policy, right? So one person writes it, one person reviews it, the second person reviews and approves it, right? And so I call it first and second person YOLO. So sometimes that first person's like, hey, you know, this code isn't going to land just because I said it looks good. And the smart person wrote it, so I don't actually have to read it, right? So the person coming behind me is totally going to check it better than I will, so just stamp, looks good. And sometimes the second person is like, well, this really smart person wrote it, and this really smart person said it looks good, so I'm just busy work. I'm just a paper pusher at this point. This probably should land. And sometimes those people meet on the same patch. It was written by somebody at 4 a.m, like, this is crazy. I don't even know if this is going to work. And that's maybe why you have outages. I don't know. In Agile, I'm not an Agile expert by any sense, but there's this idea of chickens and pigs. Are people familiar with chickens and pigs? Yeah. So, and like one of the more recent Agile descriptions, they actually dropped it, and it's like you're not supposed to say chickens and pigs anymore. And one of the justifications they gave was that it kind of leaves, like, there's a lot of chickens that do have a voice, and often that's your subject matter experts. Like, if you're at a large enough organization to have like a Java center of excellence, you want those Java people to show up and tell you how to tweak your JVM. Like, yeah, they're not totally responsible for your service, but like they know more than you and they know better, and you should listen to them, right? And the chickens and pigs stuff doesn't leave a whole lot of space for them to have a voice. But if all the changes to your JVM tunings, or really all the changes to your infrastructure, are in this Git repo that anyone in the organization can see, and the reviews that change it periodically are available for anyone to see, your subject matter experts can roll in and be like, yeah, you could ping them and be like, hey, we're looking at tuning this, blah, blah, blah. Can you look at this change review? And they're like, oh, yeah, I can look at this change review. And they comment, and they approve it. Or they don't have the ability to approve, but they definitely have the ability to provide some constructive feedback. And if you've done it correctly, they might even be able to write patches for you to make small tuning parameters just for you. We take the huge advantage of one person in OpenStack who's the only one that knows how to tweak our JVMs in our Garrett server. It's really great working with him because he's just like, yeah, do this. We're like, sweet. We have gotten into trouble for exactly the reason chickens and pigs exists, which is that person is laser focused on what they're here to do. And you need to take a certain responsibility of stepping back and looking at the wider picture. We opened ourselves up to a little security vulnerability because we configured things a little too much and didn't take the wider view of why things should be the way they are. Managers occasionally will be like, I have a login to this code review system, and just like, yeah, code review -1 this, and you're like, what? What are you doing here? But you know, when you don't have the ability to control everything in your life, sometimes you show up in somebody else's and control their life. So what I, you know, my advice to this is like, your contributors, the idea of consistent code review only works if it's consistent. If you're not spending a significant amount of your time reviewing other people's patches and you're just submitting your own and begging on chat for reviews, you're not actually doing it right. You're not going to get anywhere. You're not going to get the benefits out of it. So you can say to your manager, you can say, hey, look, like if you want to consistently review, like maybe 6 reviews a week, like that's good. But if you want to just show up once a month and like get all opinionated from remembering when you were a tech lead, that's not going to work for us. That's my advice for how to handle it. Obviously, your mileage might vary. Patch size is a thing. So this tweet basically summarizes it. small patch, I'm going to page that whole thing in, and I'm going to find a lot of things. I'm going to read it, and I'm actually going to interact with it. But a 500-line patch, I'm like, yeah, that's definitely screwing around with the async IO module in Python. I bet it looks right. Probably. Why not? Can we go back to Node? But it's this general idea that like if you want to make this work, you're going to have to make your patches smaller. Big patches are either like this, they're just like, I'm not going to engage with it, so I'll give you the rubber stamp. Or a 500-line patch might be something that you're just like, I don't want to engage with that, and I'm not going to review it, and I'm not going to give you good feedback, and then it'll quickly run into rebase problems where it's not cleanly landing. and it'll just languish there. And probably you didn't sit down and write 500 lines of code because you didn't have an itch to scratch. It was probably because you had like real work to do and you want that landed. So figure out some ways to break those into smaller chunks. You know, cascade several patches in a sequence, work with your coworkers, try to figure out how to get the smallest patch you can because that'll go through the pipeline of humans faster. So work in progress changes are really useful. Like classically operations, you know, big idea behind DevOps is classically operations doesn't have good visibility. It's like, have you guys done the servers yet? We're like, we're working on the servers, you know. We don't have necessarily the best way of communicating to outside teams or to management what we're working on and what the status of that is sometimes. So if you have infrastructure as code, you know, you can just make a little branch with your half-written Terraform and some Ansible to shove a Postgres database somewhere, and you could submit that to the code review system, like you were landing it on, like you were targeting it for mainline, but use some kind of social contract like a work in progress or a do not merge, and your coworkers will know not to land that, that it's just there as a informational. Or to, you know, you can then link it to one remote coworker and be like, hey, can you give me some feedback on this? You can link it to the other team and be like, hey, this is what I'm thinking. You can link it, you can push it up and be like, hey, I'm going on vacation. If this becomes super critical while I'm gone, somebody can pick it up and run with it. It's very useful to have that kind of ability to leave things in flight, whether they're complete or not. And then, you know, it's true everywhere else in business, so why not here too? Silence means no. So sometimes you'll write some code to modify the servers, and other people in your organization will be like, they don't want to actively fight it, because it's not that you're wrong, but right? And so to minus one would be a whole bunch of like, oh, that would be conflict, but I can just ignore this patch and provide no positive or negative reviews and just let it, you know, grow on the vine, die on the vine, right? Classically, this comes up when you have the camp that is the quick and dirty, get it done, and the long and slow and elegant, perfect solution that never comes. Not that I've ever been on either side of those. And so, you know, silence means no, this will come up, you know. But this is, again, where you say, like, especially when you're looking back on what Daniel said about key performance indicators, you kind of want your reviewers consistently reviewing. And if your reviewers aren't consistently reviewing or leaving patches that should be reviewed unreviewed, that's something we should talk about, like, hey, why is that happening? What's going on? The other side of this, of the silence means no, is what I call forcing the issue or the hostage situation, which is where if you get a small set of people who have enough approver rights to like approve something, they might go off in a little direction of their own, whether the group really approves of it or not, or one curmudgeon approves of it or not. And so sometimes you're sitting there and you're really working on some project work, and it becomes, you become aware that like some developers over there are like writing some code to like completely redo the Hadoop cluster or something, and you're like, no. And you have to drop what you're doing, go to those changes, and actually minus one all those changes in order to get them to stop, because otherwise they're just gonna ram it through because they have enough, you know, a small enough coalition. And that can be, you can feel really hostage held. And again, that's where you're gonna need to circle the wagons and talk to the community, talk to your group and be like, hey, why are we in such different thoughts on this? So those are some of the basic things, or the human elements that can I've seen come out of this. I think the biggest advantages of taking away Git push master and start using a pull request model or some kind of a code review model are fewer mistakes. Like I said, having that audit trail of who said what, when, why did this happen is just the best thing that you've, it's really, really great. I love that it empowers chickens to have a voice in in places that they otherwise would not. And it's not confrontational. It's very, usually it's pretty welcoming. And really, I think the best is the way it spreads the knowledge of your infrastructure like marmalade over toast. Everyone kind of learns a little bit more about the infrastructure through this process, stuff they might otherwise not have touched. And again, we go back to research. So there's some, I'm actually citing an academic paper in a talk for the first time, which is kind of dope. And what they basically found in this paper was that while everybody thinks it's about defect finding, the actual effects, like empirically, we're not that good at finding defects in code review. What we usually find are like, yeah, you should probably do this differently, like very trivial defects, like and defects that are trivial to find in production even if it had landed, right? What we're not good at finding in code review is the stuff that's hard to debug anyways, which is why does it drop a few 500s every time some counter reaches 300 because of some off by one error that nobody saw coming, right? So, but the benefits of knowledge transfer, increased team awareness, and creation of alternate solutions is so huge that I still think you should do this. So references, questions. My name is Spencer Crum. I work at IBM. I put on a tie for you.
Thanks.
Woo!